I am not an art critic or philosopher, not a neuroscientist or theologian. I'm a poet. But I want to talk about a serious artistic, philosophical, and theological matter, namely beauty. It is a subject we mostly ignore now, not only in society at large, but oddly, even in the arts. Beauty. The term seems quaint, almost embarrassing, a philosophical notion borrowed from an earlier, simpler age. We have mostly discarded the concept of beauty from current intellectual and artistic discourse, except as a kicking horse. It's not a word much used by literary critics or art critics nowadays, except ironically, with huge quotation marks floating in the air around it. But the absence of beauty as a positive concept has left a hole in our thinking, not only in art, philosophy, and theology, but also in education, politics, and civic life. And its absence has doomed much of what we do in education, culture, and the public sector to failure. I want to explore the issue because I believe that the rehabilitation of beauty, both as a concept and a value, would prove enormously useful to both our culture and our society. I will build my meditation around four texts, both sacred and secular, stretching across three millennia. First, I will invoke John Keats's strange assertion, "Truth is beauty, beauty truth," to which he adds, strangely, even ridiculously, "That is all ye know on earth, and all ye need to know." Second, I will consider Plato and Hume's famous hypothesis that beauty is in the eye of the beholder. Third is Oscar Wilde's assertion, "Man is hungry for beauty. There is a void." And finally, the great Russian novelist Fyodor Dostoevsky's bold, indeed seemingly outlandish claim that beauty will save the world. Since beauty is a concept that is badly understood or rejected nowadays, I need to define it briefly. The word is so commonly misused or cheapened in beauty parlors, beauty aids, beauty pageants, that it often seems more like a marketing category than a philosophical entity. So, first and most important, we must understand that beauty is not a synonym for prettiness, or any sort of external quality of being decorous or pleasantly attractive. Beauty is something deeper and more comprehensive. Perceiving beauty, we have the sense of seeing something perfect in its own way, a perfection apparent not only on the surface, but a quality we sense in the very heart of the thing. Beauty is something we perceive both externally and internally. Think of some classic examples of natural beauty: a sunset on the ocean or a towering redwood forest. Those are lovely, soothing images. But the beautiful isn't necessarily pretty. We see beauty in a hawk swooping down to seize its prey, in the swirling cone of a tornado, or in a thunderstorm sweeping across a valley. The experience of beauty is a human universal, though some people have a greater capacity for it than others, and each culture develops its codes and vocabulary to express it. Beauty has an odd and singular effect upon us, so singular and significant, in fact, that our experience of beauty deserves special attention. What happens when we experience beauty? I think the experience tends to fall into four stages. First, the arresting of attention, a moment of stillness, an unexpected slowing down to saturate ourselves in a particular phenomenon. Then comes second, a thrill of pleasure, an unusual thrill that seems disproportionate to the object's importance to us. Why would a bird or a clump of flowers, a song or an image give us such joy? The pleasure is both physical and mental, affecting our senses, our mind, and our emotions. This pleasure also has a strangely disinterested quality. We don't necessarily want to possess the object. We simply want to be in its presence. In fact, the word pleasure may actually be too mild a term for the experience. What beauty gives us is a sort of mysterious joy, a complex emotion that, unlike pleasure, is beyond our power to summon, control, or possess. Then, growing out of that joyful pleasure comes a third stage, a heightened perception of the shape or meaning of things. The thrill of looking beyond our normal sense of the world and seeing some aspect of creation. The vision may be disturbing, such as a hawk swooping on its prey, but it is linked to a sense of the truth, the deep and significant rightness of the pattern we perceive. We seem to see this beautiful and meaningful pattern unfolding in every aspect of the thing, creating a sense of unity in its variety, and yet variety in its unity. We feel an illuminating radiance from this source of beauty. It seems like a vision of redemptive order in a fallen world. And then finally, the fourth and most curious part of our experience of beauty. The moment vanishes. It is fleeting and beyond our power to control. We go from joyful elevation and sink back into the commonplace. We can stare at the painting or the landscape for another hour, but the nature of our experience changes. We have the memory of the moment, but the intense experience of stillness, pleasure, and enlightenment is gone. We all know how contemporary cultural theory explains beauty. Postmodernist thinkers do not consider beauty either a universal experience or a reliable means of perception. Nor is beauty something that has any objective existence. For them, the experience of beauty is purely a social construction. Beauty is an illusion in the eye of the beholder, a series of signs fabricated to create the impression of meaning, conditioned by social conventions, shaped by class, race, nation, gender, or ideology, a gesture by one group to raise its status and authority over another group. Beauty is all surface. Its deeper meaning is created by society. Beauty is neither true nor universal. It is a consumer product, something manufactured rather than discovered. This is a very neat and tidy intellectual strategy. But this theory doesn't feel entirely true to our experience of beauty, which so often has nothing to do with asserting our social status or endorsing some socioeconomic value system. Nor does postmodern theory explain the frequently disinterested quality of the experience of beauty when we thrill at things that threaten or marginalize us. Looking at the Grand Canyon does not aggrandize us. It makes us vividly conscious of our individual insignificance in the vast plan of nature. I would suggest that the Grand Canyon is not a subjective phenomenon, nor is it a cultural fabrication we create to assert our social status. The Grand Canyon is part of an objective reality created by something or someone other than ourselves, to which we respond properly with awe and wonder. And the experience of beauty in its most sublime state is part of that response. Objectivity and subjectivity are always interwoven in how humanity understands reality. Our current dilemma is that the postmodernist dismissal of beauty focused so intently on the subjective and culturally bound elements that it lost sight of the objective and universal ones. I'd like to suggest that we ponder for a few minutes the classical and Christian notion of beauty, which proved so enormously productive for the arts and society for most of the last 2,000 years. In this tradition, beauty is the pleasure we get in recognizing the particular manifestation of a broader universal order. Beauty is a true and powerful way of looking into the nature of reality. Beauty is therefore one of our most powerful and natural ways of knowing the world. This conviction is expressed in the Christian tradition that God intends us to recognize and love Him through His works. As the poet Gerard Manley Hopkins wrote, "The world is charged with the grandeur of God. It will flame out like shining from shook foil." Beauty is our connection to the harmonia mundi, the essential harmony of creation. It speaks to our incarnated humanity. As an expression of God's will, the world and the cosmos are intrinsically beautiful. But let's take God out of the equation and substitute modern physics or biology, and you'll have nearly an identical idea. Namely, that the order of the universe, from the microcosm of the atom to the macrocosm of the galaxy, is interconnected. The universe and natural world has form, and that form is inherently beautiful. As products of nature or evolution, we have been formed to respond to its structure. Truth is beauty. Beauty, truth. Beauty is not something we manufacture. It is something we discover and recognize. Artists do not make beauty. They participate in beauty. They perceive the beauty inherent in the world, and they represent it in their work. Thomas Aquinas, the philosopher who combined and reconciled the classical and Christian traditions, gave a clear and persuasive definition. Thomas said, "Beauty makes us delight in the very act of knowing." In the classical and Christian tradition, therefore, beauty is truthful, pleasurable, transformative, revelatory. The experience of beauty is our recognition of the deepest tendencies of the forms of the universe, our highest and most complete integrative level of understanding. The world is charged with the grandeur of God. It will flame out like shining from shook foil. The capacity to discern and appreciate beauty is universal. It is an inherent part of human nature. Why would God, or nature, or evolution give humans the powerful and instinctive pleasure reward of beauty? It cannot be coincidental or unimportant, since the response is both powerful and universal. People transfixed by beauty know something significant is happening. They feel a deep human hunger being satisfied, and once someone has experienced the beautiful, they long for more. As Oscar Wilde said, Man is hungry for beauty. There is a void. Why else do people travel thousands of miles simply to be in the presence of something they consider beautiful, but to fulfill a hunger for a pleasure that leads to meaning? Here, Thomas Aquinas has another compelling insight to offer. Thomas argued that beauty goes beyond merely the pleasurable perception of what is true. Beauty does not merely illumine, it also transforms. As it pleases and illumines, beauty elicits love. It brings us to love what God has created. Beauty leads us by pleasure to wisdom, and through wisdom to love. And love transforms us. Why does any of this matter? Beauty is nice, but isn't it also soft and vague? A sort of luxury, something very remote from the things that really matter in the world. Practical things. Beauty is not something that grown men and women in America talk about much. The proper subjects of serious discussion are wealth, power, entertainment, and technology. America has been self-proclaimed as a practical nation since our first Puritan settlers arrived. These folks saw little purpose in beauty per se, and their pragmatism has been a great strength to this nation. Americans, especially successful Americans, believe that the important things in society are best expressed in numbers and ideas, the languages of politics, business, finance, and science. These are great abstract languages that can literally move mountains or break atoms, but they are not universal languages. The trouble with this practical worldview is that most of the world, nearly all of the time, understand things not as concepts or numbers, but only as totalities. We live in a material world which, as incarnate beings made up of both body and soul, we perceive holistically, simultaneously with our intellect, emotions, physical senses, imagination, intuition, and memory. We most naturally and characteristically perceive embodied truths rather than abstractions. We instinctively seek beauty and not logic. The people who change the world generally make their impact by embodying their message, by telling it in stories, songs, poems, images, and symbols. Social and political change is not primarily driven by ideas. The social and political revolution of the 1960s, for example, was not primarily created by ideology, but by songs, movies, clothes, and even hairstyles. These were the things that communicated to and convinced tens of millions of kids to change culture, morals, and politics. This revolution wasn't about logic or practicality. It was about everything that not shaving or wearing shoes or a bra could communicate. It was a search for and a celebration of a new sense of beauty. In a society which was practical and prosperous, but no longer seemed beautiful to the young. Even in business, an understanding of beauty proves decisive. Steve Jobs claimed his central animating idea for Apple came not from studying engineering, but calligraphy, and realizing that the form of a thing shapes its function and meaning. The form of a thing expresses, intentionally or unintentionally, its reality, its essence, and almost everyone in society recognizes this fact. although most people cannot easily articulate why. The failure of the public sector in this nation is embodied in thousands of ugly buildings and public spaces. These places have been built practically. They are practical and functional in every respect, except in practice, since they communicate to the average person that the citizen is just a number in a game of cost efficiency and crowd control. The experience that Americans have walking up the steps of the Lincoln Memorial is the experience of beauty, the embodiment of our political vision of the beauty of democracy expressed in great architecture, great sculpture, great landscaping, and great language carved calligraphically in the very walls of the memorial. This is the moment that Frank Capra captured so powerfully in Mr. Smith Goes to Washington. By contrast, the experience of visiting the FBI headquarters less than a half a mile away is disconcerting, dehumanizing, and alienating. No wonder its ugly and brutalist exterior was used as a symbol for government deceit and cold bureaucracy in the X-Files. The architecture didn't communicate a government of the people, by the people, for the people, but a government by secret police. The forms of things express meanings whether we intend them to or not. When the U.S. was a smaller, poorer country, the public buildings expressed the greatness of our nation. Just look at a Depression-era post office with marble floors, carved wooden counters, brass fixtures, and often an original mural. This was a vision of a beautiful society to which any citizen who entered could participate in. Today, the post office is all vinyl and plexiglass. It offers no vision but expediency. We are not citizens, but customers in a cut-rate 99-cent store vision of democracy. No wonder the public doesn't believe in the government. The government seems not to believe in them as alert, intelligent, sensory human beings. Until we discover how to embody our civic vision in beauty, the public sector will remain more X-Files and less Mr. Smith Goes to Washington. Man hungers for beauty. There is a void. If the state does not address this hunger, doesn't nourish this appetite, if it doesn't even acknowledge that it exists, then citizens become detached and alienated from their civic identity and retreat to a private world. That is happening everywhere around us. Even in the Catholic Church, where fewer Catholics gather each Sunday for Mass, at least in part because the church no longer offers them a beautiful vision of God's presence and their own existence, but mostly preaches moral obligations and ethics. Beauty, once opened to the divine, is now mostly shut. When Jesus spoke unto the multitudes, he did not lay out abstract laws. He told stories. He embodied truth in poetry, in beautiful language that arrests our attention. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Jesus did not ask us merely to think our way to salvation, but also to see and hear and feel and taste it. Oh, taste and see the Lord is good. The poet John Keats was right to say, truth is beauty, beauty truth. And if that beauty is in the eye of the beholder. It is as the beholder looks into the heart of existence. The important thing to remember is that beauty is not only revelatory, it is also transformative. It leads us by pleasure to knowledge, and by knowledge to love. If beauty addresses our highest level of integrative understanding at how the world exists and what our place is in creation, then art is the universal human means of awakening and expanding and refining this cognitive power. Art, unlike philosophy or science, speaks to us in the fullness of our humanity as incarnate beings. The challenge of life is to find personal meaning in a fallen world, to find, in other words, truth, and to live in consonance with it, to seek grace, and through grace, redemption. We must do this not as bodiless spirits, but as hairy, heavy, hungry human beings. When society abandons art, when it neglects beauty, it loses its most powerful way to speak to its citizens and communicate its values. Beauty inspires us to transform ourselves and our world. It gives us a vision of our own possibilities. Art awakens us to our lives. It enlarges and refines our humanity. It calls us to understand the complexities of our own existence. Its pleasure also allows us to feel the truth of insights we might not otherwise willingly embrace. Beauty leads us by pleasure, illumination, and love to transform ourselves in accordance with the beautiful objects of our desire. When Dostoevsky said, "Beauty will save the world," he was not issuing a social formula. He was uttering a prophecy. What he implied was that without beauty, there is no practical way to change the world, no universal means of communication and inspiration that will suffice, no equally powerful way for humanity to know and love what is good and true. The world is charged with the grandeur of God. It is not an abstract or intangible grandeur. It surrounds us. We feel it. We need it. Man hungers for beauty. There is a void. We are, by our very nature, drawn to this grandeur, this glory, this beauty. We ignore it at the risk of misunderstanding ourselves, the world, and all of creation, because in some essential way, only beauty will save the world.